And so there was a strong sentiment with respect to two regions that in the deliberations came out as distinctive in character, but without compromising sovereignty and territorial integrity. And these were in ARM, Autonomous Region of Muslim Mindanao, and the Cordilleras. The committee report that was sent back to the committee for redrafting was the one on federalism, because the committee on local government's report was for a federal system of government, and that was not the sentiment of the whole. Said, all right, there will be two regions that deserve more autonomy, and the principle of decentralization was there in the local government article, but we were not ready for federalism because of we're an archipelago and we have different languages, and it might be a disunifying rather than a unifying approach, and so the unitary form of government was the majority sentiment.
We can dismiss the Constitution as just another piece of paper. In fact, the armed groups consider it as the greatest obstacle to meaningful peace negotiations. For the MNLF, the requirement for a plebiscite to pass an autonomous region contravenes the spirit of the 1976 Tripoli Agreement, which remains their framework document. They rejected the Constitution and the Organic Act that was passed. For the CPP, they consider themselves outside the ambit of the Constitution and seek the preeminence of their own laws and government. The dream of the MILF for an Islamic state will never pass the separation of church and state clause that has long been entrenched in our constitutional history. To the armed groups, the Constitution has become a straitjacket. This perspective must be recognized in order to be addressed. Armed groups, in turn, must accept that the government is constrained to act within the confines of the Constitution. Even then, such should not preclude what lawyer Suleiman Santos Jr. called constitutional accommodation that is achieved through meaningful constitutional dialogue. For example, instead of an Islamic state, why not an Islamic system within the system? Such can be founded on the constitutionally established right to religious freedom and the internationally accepted principle of the right to self-determination. Similarly, the superior claims of the state to national sovereignty can and should be upheld by equally superior values of democracy, social justice, and people's rights. Mutual accommodations can be found in these interstices. To the armed groups, the Constitution is a shackle, but it has also provided them with tools to defend themselves and to exact their just claims. They realize that any constitutional change needed to achieve just solutions can only happen in the manner prescribed by the Constitution itself. But the political leadership must do its part.
The remaining 46 commissioners affixed their signatures on the English and Filipino versions of the charter, and most of them expressed their satisfaction.
Of course, not a perfect document. Nothing in this world is perfect. But I think that it's a very good fundamental law for the land.
Maybe we are not achieving as fast as we had thought social justice. And not resolving old issues in these areas. No? So I think that it's time for us to look back and say, was the agenda of the Constitution a valid one? I still think the agenda is valid. There are certain assumptions that perhaps were too optimistic on our part.
That Constitution was a product of the times, of the period. And we were coming from a dictatorship. We were coming out of an experience of abuse of military power, human rights violations. So the imperative for peace was certainly a very strong impulse.
A constitution is only as good as the people and its lead and their leaders kind of allow. And therefore, it's very important that, you know, people are not kind of distracted by the mechanics, by the forms.
Just putting flesh, you know, and getting some of the younger, more progressive, and more people-oriented congressmen to see, to come up with, you know, using these provisions.
We cannot have a real democracy without real elections, and that's why electoral reform is very important. It is ultimately the alternative option to non-peaceful means.
I was a professor of political science. I became peace student because of the public hearings. You know, it became very clear to me that was what we lacked in this country, and that document, in some way, if it was implemented properly, responded. But the Constitution is honored more in the breach.
So, if we promote democracy, you know, deepen democracy in the Philippines, and then other democracies emerge in the region, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, ultimately, hopefully, Burma, if democracy takes root in these countries, or even China, you know, if they, then we won't need to go to war against each other. To me, the struggle for democracy will lead to peace when we actually create mechanisms of democratic accountability, for example, make it real. But that's what we don't have right now.
Mahalin.